Russell Radio.
Our next guest is the winner of the 2012 NPC Junior USA Championships. He won the super heavyweight and overall. And it is, I'm actually proud to have him here because we've had him on RX Muscle many times before in the past, and he's finally in the winner's circle. Welcome, Dan Neumeier.
How's it going, Dave? How's everything going?
Well, are you still gloating from the weekend? I mean, you have to ride that wave of high, you know, the highness, you know, for at least a couple of days, I think.
Well, I don't. I'm actually kind of quite the opposite, polar opposite. I don't really get too big on that stuff. You know, for me, it's a good notch, but keep going. You know, I just kind of look at, you know, it's a great win, but obviously my goal is to get a lot higher and see if we can compete for a professional pro card and whatnot. But I'm very thankful, but obviously, you know, I'm still very hungry, so it's just part of the system, and we just keep on going. But I'm happy that I kind of ended my drought. I haven't gotten overall in about 4 years, and it kind of sucks.
Yeah, so tell me about it. But you know, you start doubting whether you can win or not. But you know, you did something smart, and I want to you know, give you some accolades for that, because in 2008, I think you won some Atlanta overall show, NPC show, and you went to the Nationals, and you did the same thing the year after that. You didn't do well. And you said to yourself, I got to do something different. And so you took a step back, which I think, you know, a lot of guys are afraid to do, and you decided you were going to do the Junior Nationals, the Junior USA, and you did that for 2 years, and now you finally, you won the Junior USA this year. But a lot of guys' egos get in the way, and they're afraid to do that. What mindset went on? Did anyone advise you, or did you come up with this on your own?
Well, obviously, I run through a lot of stuff through my coach, John White, and everything, and get his opinion and whatnot. But the fact of the matter is that most of us are never going to be the Jay Cutlers, Phil Heath, and the most amazing genetics of all time. And we gotta do the work. Gotta put it good enough to walk onto a stage of that nature, take my trophy, go home, get my pro card, and go, and I'm done. I got to put my time in, got to work, got to put effort. It's going to take some time, you know, and I don't even know if I'll ever make it to that level, but, you know, I got to chip away. You know, it's just, I'm not blessed with the genetic ability. A lot of those guys that just kind of come in, take it, run with it, and they're just so good that they just take it. You know, I'm just not that good. So I'm going to put my time in, work, and see what happens, and if it's meant to be, it'll happen.
Now, you're in the category of about 95% of the bodybuilders out there, so don't feel bad. I fell into that category as well. And, you know, there isn't a lot of Ed Vincentepanis and Phil Heaths out there who is gonna, you know, do two shows and turn pro, or Cedric McMillan's for that matter. So it is a good idea to do these junior shows, get your face known. Now, look, you're on Heavy Muscle Radio now. You're the NPC Junior USA overall champion. A lot of people will know who you are, which will raise your stock a little bit. And I think that more people should take a note out of your book here. And because now people know you, the judges know you, and you know, when you have a, when you're a big guy like you, how tall are you?
I'm 5'9".
Okay, you appear a lot even taller on stage, I think. And you know, when you're
I don't feel that way.
A lot of people. Aaron thought you were 6 feet. So, but then again, he probably needs glasses. But
I'm a midget.
But it does take a long time as a super heavyweight to fill out your frame. And it's sometimes a good idea to take your time in this journey. What it really is.
Yeah, it is. It does take a lot of time. Actually, it takes a longer time to put on muscle than it actually does to diet off fat. So I mean, it takes a long, long time, and people don't seem to understand that. I wish it was that easy. I wish it was that easy just to go up on there. But again, you know, we are who we are. You got to go with what you got and use it to the best of your ability. And like I said, I don't know if I'll ever be able to get to that level. I'll certainly take some stabs and some swings, but we'll see. We'll see what happens. I don't know. I don't know what's in store.
Well, how did you start with the whole bodybuilding thing? What got you into the sport to begin with, and what made you first want to compete?
Well, when I graduated from high school back in '97, I really didn't have an athletic output or some kind of competitive nature for me, which made me feel really very empty. I started training, and a couple of my best friends and some of my mentors, Adam Applegate and Brian Willingham, both came to me and talked to me about competing and whatnot, and I guess just kind of the intersection, so to speak, started then. And I did my first show in the year 2000, And I've been competing most off and on. I had a little break in from 05 to 08. And then I just continue competing. But, you know, like I said, it just kind of, you meet the right people that, you know, they think you can do well, you know. And from that point, you take it from there. Fortunately, I was grounded by a lot of good people that, you know, they were smart, intelligent, but they also put life before just bodybuilding. Some people, it's 100%, 120% bodybuilding, nothing else. And then when that falls through, it kind of leaves them with nothing more in life. So I'm kind of trying to put all my eggs in different baskets, some in a couple different ones, not just all bodybuilding.
What else do you do? To tell our listeners this, in case they know, what was your background coming out of, you know, school and stuff like that, and what do you do for a job?
I graduated from University of Iowa with my bachelor's in health and sports studies and then a minor in exercise science. I kind of traveled around, lived in Phoenix for a little bit, Phoenix, Arizona, and then I moved to work in different odd-end jobs I just did not really care for. Some medical supply, some nutritional stuff, nothing that was really my thing. I actually chose to go back to school in 2009. I originally went to a chiropractic school down here called Life University.
Sure.
That lasted for about a quarter. It just was not my thing. I ended up transferring into their master's of exercise science, and I'm currently going to graduate June with my master's in exercise and sports science. And we are currently, I think about the second week of June, me and my wife are heading down to Texas. Their professor placed a wonderful phone call to a school down there as far as they have a grad assistant position and a PhD possibility, and to work on my kinesiology and work on my PhD and my doctorate.
Wow.
So I'm really excited. I'm really hoping that falls comes through, and we could be in Texas by August. So I'm really hoping that comes through, because I would really like to take a stab at working on my doctorate in that area.
Now, what does one do with a doctorate in exercise physiology?
Well, it does a multitude of different things. You can obviously teach would be the one of the biggest things. You can write. You can also work with athletes or whatnot. Some people have been hired as certain positions at the CDC, you know, and I think obviously again there's research, not a whole lot of money.
Well, what's your interest? You must have a specific interest that you're aiming towards, or you wouldn't be going for your doctorate. You know?
Sure, I do. One of the things I've been confronted with by a lot of professors since I've been working my master's, is they all felt that I'm a very, very good teacher. The way I talk, the way I present information, the way I like truth and stuff, and how I kind of like to help people. And they really felt that I would be a great associate professor or something of that nature at a high-level school. And I kind of entertained the fact and started asking questions probably about, you know, 6 months ago of different professors. And I find myself more and more wanting to further educate in the fields where I can help people and educate people and individuals, and even work, you know, with certain, if I want to, with clients, bodybuilding clients, athletes of different nature. And it's an area I really enthrall in, and something I really like. I'm the nerdy kid that sits home on Friday and Saturday night reading and researching my exercise physiology books. I'm not really an outgo kind of partying person. But fortunately, my wife, you know, she doesn't go out much, or, you know, we're kind of sit home and do that stuff. But
Aaron told me you're married to a Jewish girl. Is that true?
Oh, yes. I got myself a Jew. Yeah, she's the bank, you know. She takes care of all the money and everything. And, you know, it's a good stereotype. It really is. She doesn't, I tease her about it, but dang, she's good at it. You know, you guys are, Jewish people are very, very good at what they do. I mean, I don't argue. I just say, you got it, honey. You take care of it, because I'll screw it up.
But your bodybuilding's an expensive sport, too, so.
Oh, God, yeah. And then that's, I drive her nuts with that alone. My food bill is just out of control.
Crazy.
I mean, I'm getting by. You know, like I said, this year kind of made some cutbacks. You know, I wasn't buying egg whites. I just went to old eggs and stuff. I really made some cutbacks. But you know what? I like old school stuff, man. I just, I don't need a whole lot of new stuff. And I'm just kind of kept, like, it's very simple this year. And I like it, man. I like simplicity. I really do.
I tell people, the bodybuilders would be better off getting food contracts rather than supplement contracts. You know?
Oh, man, if I could, we have a place called down here, Marietta Diner. If you're ever down here in Atlanta, I'd say to go eat it. But they give you so much food here for cheap. I'm like, why don't you please people sponsor me? We own half your restaurant.
That's right.
So,
that's
you know, right. I mean, we spend a lot of money.
You could set up a little like exercise room in the back for all the out of shape people.
I'd love to, man, because like I said, we eat there so much, it's out of control. I mean, the food is just, as you know, Dave, food is just. It's so expensive. Because you're just eating so many calories.
People don't realize the cost of the food. Yeah, that's the most expensive.
No, you're like, it is a lot of money, I tell you.
Well, I think Atlanta's probably cheaper than New York, but probably not cheaper than Iowa. How did you wind up in Iowa at school? I always wonder how people get to these weird places.
Well, my family, like I said, I was originally born in Iowa City, Iowa.
Oh, you are? I didn't know that.
Yeah,
okay.
Originally born there. Here's the funny thing. I am not an Iowa fan. Some of my family is Iowa fans. Some of my family was Ohio State. I kind of went the Ohio State route. I tried to transfer to Ohio State. I had a girlfriend lived in the actual state for a while. And so I'm a huge Buckeye fan. I've been trying. Actually, I tried, you know, emailing and trying to get in touch with the doctoral staff up there. But mm-hmm. I want to get to Columbus somehow. It's kind of tough. But I am, like I said, I am Midwest through and through. I am I'm from the Midwest. I do not have a Southern accent since I moved down here. I refuse. Like I said, the Midwest is pretty cool, man. That's where all the dairy and beef is at. So
yeah, it's kind of cool that you can move all over the place and that you're flexible like that. So
You gotta be flexible in life, man. Gotta be.
Yeah. Now, when you do these, when you go to these conferences or you go to these, when you're in school, talking to these professors and everything like that. I mean, I imagine you must be like oodles of muscle bigger than every single person in that program,
sure.
Right?
Sure. And if you walk around, like I said, you have a bullseye on you, and people, you're different. You know, you're not what I would call the stereotypical lab rat or a professor. I am different. I do stand out. But I'm also, go back to my personality, I'm not one of those kind of guys that wears a string tank top to class and, hey, look at me. I'm the one wearing the big baggy clothes, and I kind of, you know, sit in front of the classroom, and I try to redirect the attention to what, you know, it is.
You know, probably think you're the fat guy in the front row.
And I'll run with it, man. As long as they can think that I'm the big football player in the front, I don't care. You know, I just, I'm there for education. I'm not there to talk about what I look like. And I do a pretty good job separating my professional life and my personal life. I started bodybuilding because there's two areas I just kind of keep away from one another. It's best for everything. Because some people just get too nosy, and some people, you know, there's a lot of insecurities in this world.
Is the program more applicable to you because you could actually apply it to what you do in the gym? I mean, because sometimes it becomes so esoteric at a certain level, probably even at the doctorate level, that these guys are like, you know, talking about things that has no practical application, you know, in there, at least for the person who's dealing with it. You actually can apply it when you go to the gym.
Yeah, it's actually, I've learned a lot, especially in the biomechanics area. I've learned quite a bit in muscle functioning, physiology, nutritional aspects. And you learn, you know, like I said, learning through these individuals, you kind of stomp on those mythological claims that seem to rid the bodybuilding world of stuff, and it just kind of gets old, you know. So you try to go on stamping out these fires of mythology people believe.
Tell me some of the big myths that you've dispelled after studying this stuff in school.
Weight. Oh, there's a big one for it. Weight is aspect. You have to lift stupid, enormous amounts of weight in order to get big. Now, again, this is all relative to each person. Everyone is different. Everyone responds to certain things differently. But in bodybuilding, is more of a cosmetic-based activity. It's not a sports performance, per se, training. You know, it doesn't really matter if you bench 6,000 pounds. Is that going to make you look better on stage? That's what it comes down to. So there's a separation of ego and also sports training of what people used to do for actual sports and cosmetic training for bodybuilding. It's a little bit, it's a different, there is crossover, but there is myth, you know? But then again, you see guys like Ronnie Coleman, Johnny Jackson lifting enormous amounts of weight, and it works for them.
They're the 5% that are genetic freaks.
Exactly.
Go to the gym now, has there been like exercise where you say, you know what? Oh my God, was I so stupid the way I was doing this? functionally it does not make sense to do this, and you've altered the way you train on specific exercises. And if that's true, tell us a couple of these little things that you might have learned over the years.
For instance, standing lateral. If you look at if people do lateral raises, the first what, how many 15, 20, 30 degrees of the actual movement is actually wasted. You don't actually have no stimulus because the weight's just hanging. If you actually turn the body by a 90-degree angle, like you're laying sideline on a bench, right, the strongest point of the movement of that is when your arm is at your side.
Interesting.
And when you abduct the weight, that's when the actual movement, you get most of your force production at that point. So you do the side lying on an incline bench or something of that nature, and you get more of the tension on the muscle than you were if you were standing.
That's a good point.
Not wasting the exercise, you're actually using the tension to your benefit and putting it where you want it to be.
So what you're saying is to lay on the on your side on an angle, on a 45-degree angle, you'll be creating more tension throughout the entire range of motion of that side lateral.
Exactly. And if you're, again, cosmetic training, range of motion is severely limited. You don't have to have full range of motion because if I'm trying to train the deltoid, why do I need my trap to actually do the work for me? Mm. Doesn't make sense to me, you know? Close grip upright rows. You know, when people do that, and they basically a trap movement. You know, go wide grip becomes more of a shoulder deltoid movement.
That's,
you know, a lot of different things of just biomechanically taking away secondary, tertiary muscle groups while trying to focus on primary.
Well, you should.
That's
interesting.
Goal.
You should put out a little instructional video. I have to get you go down there and film you doing some stuff. You know, it's interesting because I always felt that the side lateral machine. I do it one arm at a time. I feel it gets a better effect on the side laterals because you always have that tension because of the way the machine is set up.
Exactly, because it's the way it's supposed to do it, you know. And I mean, another thing too is, for instance, on the deltoid, you know, if you can stand from the front and the back. A lot of people they sit in those machines and they sit forward and they put where the handlebars are. They basically move their shoulder anterior. Well, when you move your shoulder anterior to your body and abduct it, what do you think is getting most stimulus? Well, the anterior deltoid. Can the judge really see that from the front and back? Now, what you're trying to create is an illusion. If you internally rotate your arm, so your thumb is kind of pointing down,
right,
and then do those lateral raises, you hit more of the outside of the medial deltoid. Again, creating more width to your shoulder, also creating more of that illusion of width for the judges to see. They can see that.
Very interesting. And you happen to have a good set of delts in you, so you must know what you're talking about.
Well, you can't always say because everyone's got some body parts that are just lovely and great, they just respond pretty quickly. But, you know, it's just a... I try to focus on areas, slap it on here. You know, my biggest area that's been hard for me is my back. You know, I'm trying to slap it on, but it just doesn't want to stick. You know, but everyone has those body parts that just goes. I've always been a pusher.
Got to get back into the textbooks for the back. You got to find some new tips for the back.
And I've gone back to deadlifting and back to deadlifting some rows. I'm trying to reduce my range of motion in that. And a higher volume stuff. I brought my lats out a little bit, but it's just that body part that everyone has that goes, not going, and that's mine. It's just taking a lot of time, and it's just going to take time, a lot of time to do it.
Looking at your pictures from the Junior USA, did you feel you brought the package that you wanted? I mean, conditioning-wise, presentation-wise, were you happy with yourself?
I'm never happy, dude. It was better. It was better than it was at Junior Nationals and the Junior States before. I was drier. That was a goal, so I did succeed in that. Was it where I wanted to be? Close. But I still want to be about 15% drier. I don't know what is with me. I get close to the stage. I don't know if it's a nervous thing or I don't know what's going on, but I can be dry as a board. Morning at 7, 6, 9 o'clock. But I get on stage at 11, I start getting a film, and I have no idea. I have no water coming in. Mm-hmm. You know, I kept sodium low. I don't know what it is with my skin, but it is, so I'm trying to figure out. I've gotten better. Got better this year, but still need to figure out why. I've done it before, right, where I've gone stage pretty dry. I'm just not understanding why it always seems to happen at that point. Because I had lines in my butt the night before I even sent them to some pictures to PJ, and it was pretty nice, but then all of a sudden, poof.
You know, sometimes some people get a cortisol response. You know, they get a little nervous and they release cortisol and it can smooth you out. You know, and sometimes it has something to do with diet related too. You know, right before the show.
I know. I'm trying to think of a way to cancel that. Look at this.
You got
to
go for like hypnosis or something like that.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what it is with me. I'm laying in the back trying to sleep, relaxing. All of a sudden, poof. You know, but I'm happy. I shouldn't say I'm appreciative. I'm happy that I got there. I made some adjustments. Went old school. Actually, kind of low carb it Thursday and Friday into a show to keep that water off. Yeah. And I'm happier. But
maybe
like,
you're carb sensitive. Yeah, that could be a problem.
I've always been that way. You know, I mean, sometimes I am, but sometimes I'm not. You know, after this show, we eat a lot of food on a Saturday. I only gained, Sunday, I gained 5 pounds. That's it. Nothing.
Yeah. Well, maybe, maybe it is nerves, but you'll have to figure it out. Now, what's next for you? Do you, are you going to take the rest of the year off? Or are you going to, and you know, kind of ride this Junior USA victory? Or are you going to maybe move up to and do the Nationals of the USA?
I want to do Nationals. As I was talking to Aaron, everything kind of depends on what happens with this interview. I go down to Texas, and if we can get in and they say, come on down, we'll start. We move and everything works out perfectly. I might still throw my hat in for Nationals. Ooh. But it just kind of moving to a different state, getting your whole life set up, it's a little difficult, a little tough to do that. But I'm not going to say no. Any way I look at it, both ways will be good. I need to get a whole year and a half to put some size on my back and keep on going, or I'm trying to see if I can do Nationals. So I'm not losing any way I look at it.
Yeah, it's tough. People don't realize it's really tough when you're in an educational program to really like diet, because what happens is when you're low calories, your body your brain doesn't want to sit down and read stuff and learn, and you're yourself, and you know, you get introverted and you don't want to do anything, and it is tougher. You have to admit.
Yeah. Oh, it is tough, like I said. But I mean, I balance pretty well, and then I also enjoy what I'm studying, so it does make it easier. But again, throwing myself in a PhD program is a little bit different than what I'm doing now. So we'll see what happens. I don't know. I'm kind of walking into a no man's land right now, and if it does work out, then it will. But I'm not looking at negative either way. You know, if I get a whole year and a half off and do Nationals next year, that's fine. That gives me a whole year to show. I love being on stage around 260, 265, somewhere around there with a bigger, better back. I'd love to. That'd be great.
And what'd you weigh at this show?
I weighed 254.
Okay, so that's doable. And then maybe next time we talk, you'll be Dr. Dan.
Well, it'll take some time to get the dissertation and everything working, but I'm really hoping. I'm really hoping that I do come back and I can be. There's not very many bodybuilders / meatheads out there that have a PhD behind the back of their name. I definitely would like to have that.
At least not in the men's field. The women all have. There's a lot of PhDs in the women, but the men don't really seem to do that too much.
They're smart. Those guys are smart. Guys, I don't know why guys don't get enough of them. Not too many out there, though. But
well, you know what? Women have better work ethic, I think, than men. That's why.
That is true. And that's why, but it takes a lot to do balance all, and that's why we're pretty good at it. But I can do it. It is possible.
Well, congratulations to you. The NPC Junior USA overall champion, Dan Neumeyer, and hopefully he'll become Dr. Dan, and you'll keep us updated on what's going on with you.
Yes, sir. Will do.
All right. Thanks, Dan.
Thanks, Dave.
That was Dan Neumeyer, 2012 NPC Junior USA overall champion. Nice guy. And, you know, a guy who's focused. I like to see people that have other interests other than just the bodybuilding, and it keeps them, balanced. And balance is what bodybuilding is all about, and about all the success is about, because you can't keep a balanced lifestyle. Eventually, when things go wrong or things don't go the way you want, you feel like you're hopeless. So as a bodybuilder, you have to find other interests, and you have to stay grounded, and you have to realize that the bodybuilding is not the do-all or end-all, because injuries pop up, you know, things go wrong, and sometimes shows don't go the way you plan, and you don't want to feel like you want to kill yourself if all goes wrong. And Dan has got some great balance, and I'm proud of him that he is sticking with his guns and sticking to his educational program, because obviously bodybuilders have a limited lifespan out there, and it's important. I also want to congratulate Cedric McMillan on a great victory at the New York Pro Championships. We will probably see him next at the Olympia. For now, though, we're out of time. I'd like to thank Dan Neumeier for stopping by. Until next week, remember, with Heavy Muscle Radio, truth hurts.
Heavy Muscle Radio is a presentation of RxMuscle.com, the truth in bodybuilding. Tune in next week at the same time for another round with Dave Palumbo only on Heavy Muscle Radio.